It's a very exciting time for semiconductor research, not only because it is important for our existing microelectronics to make our computer, cell phone to be more efficient, consume less power, but also it's important to open up future opportunities for medical, for healthcare, for future quantum technologies.
This is the Discovery Files podcast from the U.S. National Science Foundation. I'm Nate Potker. Semiconductors are the backbone of most modern electronic devices, from smartphones and home appliances to MRI scanners and satellites. Breakthroughs in semiconductors and microelectronics will be key to overcoming limits in critical areas, including artificial intelligence, quantum computing, manufacturing, and communications. We're joined by Zidion Mee, a professor of electrical engineering and computer science at the University of Michigan. His group is working on a new class of semiconductors with great potential for next-generation microelectronic devices. Professor Mee, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you very much, Nate. It's my great honor and pleasure to have this opportunity to talk to you.
So I need to ask you about wurtzite ferroelectric nitrides. What is this?
This is a material that's commonly used in our daily lives. For example, we use this material for LED lighting. They are also in our cell phones and literally everywhere. And the second most produced semiconductors on this planet, next only to silicon. And so this material has been around, but for decades, this material is known to be piezoelectric. Let me briefly explain what piezoelectric is. So this material has a fix the polarization inside of the material. And when you apply an electric field, you can generate a strain, vice versa, so they can also be used as sensors. So the ferroelectric is a subset of the piezoelectric family. By saying ferroelectric, we mean the electrical polarization in the material can be reversed back and forth when we apply an external electric field. Ferroelectric is not new, first discovered around 100 years ago, 1920, by a graduate student when he was doing PhD at University of Minnesota. But for nearly 100 years, the ferroelectric materials are mostly oxide-based ferroelectrics. They have been used almost everywhere, for example, in sensors, in industry settings, in medical devices, in ultrasonic. However, the oxide ferroelectric also has some fundamental limitations. For example, they are not stable in harsh environment. It's very difficult to make them compatible with the mainstream semiconductor processing and therefore limit some of their applications. And here we have one of the most produced semiconductor material, and now we can turn it into ferroelectric. You can imagine the enormous opportunities this can open. And that's what we are really excited about.
How do you store information inside an electric field?
Electric field in the semiconductor can have positive or negative directions. So, which means we can switch the direction back and forth for ferroelectric material. And then give us the opportunity to store the information. For example, we can define a positive direction, polarization, as the information one, a negative as zero, right? Then we can store the information. We can electrically reverse the polarization, which means we can write or reset the information in the material. Or we can read the material by applying an electrical signal. We can read the information stored this. The most beautiful part of this is the information is stored there without applying any external bias. So once you set the polarization there, it will stay there without supplying any external power. So this is a so-called nonvolatile memory device. And so imagine if we can build atomic scale memory cells with very little power consumption, and we can integrate billions or trillions of them on a very small size chip, and then going to really revolutionize computing communication in the years to come.
What is the benefit of lower power consumption with semiconductors?
This is a very important question, directly relates to to power consumption, computing, communication is consuming enormous amount of power as we speak. And with the AI, this is going to grow exponentially. So how to reduce the power consumption at the device level will be very critical. Now, let's first talk about this power consumption. There are many factors that will affect the device power consumption. For example, for memory device, right, how much power we need to reset or write the signal, how much power we need to use to read the signal, or how much power we need to use to store the information, to maintain the information. So what's really great about this material is non-volatile. We do not need to have extra power to maintain the information.
What is the unique polarization capability in this material?
For the quasi ferroelectrics, there have been interest and studies by many research groups. But for a long time, there is a fundamental question is, for this quasi ferroelectric, once we switch the polarization, then we have opposite polarization within the same material, just like a bar magnet, right? The north and south pole, when you try to put them together within one material, how can they be stabilized? And specifically in the quasi ferroelectrics, when we switch the polarization, only part of the material, the polarization is switched. So there will be domains of different polarization. And the interface, we may have two positive electric fields facing each other. How can this be stabilized? This has remained a fundamental question. So that's one of the studies we recently published. We show that, and this domain interface, we have a new atomic thin structure, which through this dangling bond electrons, and we found this, and this domain interface, we have a new atomically thin structure. And this atomically thin structure, different from the host material, and has unbonded electrons, which can stabilize the polarization discontinuity. Not only that, this electron density is much higher than that in the traditional gallium nitride transistors. The density is like 100 times higher. So provide future opportunities to design nanoscale device with better performance. Now come back to the power consumption due to the writing or reading for a memory device or other devices. It directly relate to the efficiency and also relate to the device size. And for the quasi ferroelectric nitrides, nowadays we can glue them atomic layer by atomic layer. So we can make them very, very small, and therefore the power consumption can be drastically reduced together with very high integration density. Billions, billions of devices can be integrated on a very small size chip.
Thinking about the WorldSight ferroelectric nitride semiconductors, how is this discovery going to really impact the next generation of semiconductors that people see in their devices?
It's going to impact in several different ways. And the first, let me briefly explain. Gallium nitride devices are already in many business sectors, right? Almost in our daily lives. And now we have this ferroelectricity, and it can enhance the performance functionality of existing devices. For example, it can make our cell phone to have stronger signal, less noise, to operate more efficiently. And secondly, it also broadens the scope of the traditional oxide ferroelectric beyond what can possibly be done. Oxide ferroelectric is a wonderful material. However, this material has some challenges when operating in harsh environment. For example, in aerospace or spacecraft, in electrical vehicles where you often have very high temperature or other extreme conditions. These quasi ferroelectric nitrides are known to be very stable at a very high temperature, up to 1,000 degrees Celsius. And that can have immediately important applications. And also this wurtzite ferroelectric nitrides can be grown or synthesized atomic layer by atomic layer. And you can really scale this to very small size and with excellent performance. So that will help to make electronic devices with better performance, with high integration density, and also this material can be integrated with the mainstream electronics, silicon and gallium nitride, which will all enhance the functionality of our future microelectronics. The exact scope and impact remain to be seen, but many colleagues in academia, in the industry, we are very excited with the enormous potential of this new class of semiconductors.
Are there challenges getting buy-in from industry partners when you develop a new material or a new strategy to introduce these materials into devices that they are currently producing?
For any new material, there are important considerations how this is going to be adopted by the industry, how this is going to be integrated with their production lines. Some materials may have wonderful properties, but if they cannot be adopted by industry, they will only remain as a subject of research interest. Very fortunately, for this material family, it is based on an existing material, gallium nitride, is the second most produced semiconductor in industry. And we only add one or two elements into this material, and then we can transform this material to have wonderful properties not existing before. As a matter of fact, this material has already been adopted in our cell phones, next generation cell phones, and we'll see more of those in the future.
I want to ask you about the importance of critical minerals in semiconductors.
Critical minerals are very important for semiconductor. For example, gallium, indium, those are being used in the industry, but those are also considered critical materials. And part of the research we are doing, among many other researchers, is to develop new semiconductors that can use more abundant elements and have more enhanced functionality.
How hard will it be to adopt other materials that are more common or easier to use to replace the current critical minerals that are being used?
For any new semiconductor material, it often takes time for the industry to adopt. There's always a question about compatibility with semiconductor processing, or the existing ones, among other factors. It's not an easy answer to your question, but I can give one example. For example, in the material we are working on, and we are adding new elements into gallium nitride. So potentially we can have enhanced the functionality by using less gallium or less indium, and therefore have less demand on the critical minerals without affecting the processing too much.
How has NSF support impacted your work so far?
I'm very grateful for the support from NSF. NSF not only provides support for supporting graduate students' material supplies, but it provides immense flexibility for us to explore the unknown domain in semiconductor and related research. It also helps us to build a network to collaborate and connect with other researchers, not only at the University of Michigan, but also in other institutions. So this is really a very important resource for us and for university research to continue to make breakthrough advances in many sectors.
For my last question today, I want to ask you about the future of semiconductors. Where do you see it developing, or where do you see your work going in the next few years?
So it's a very exciting time for semiconductor research, not only because it is important for our existing microelectronics, for example, to make our computer, cell phone to be more efficient, consume less power, to make our communication to be faster, to be more secure, but also it's important to open up future opportunities, for example, for medical, for healthcare, for future quantum technologies. Perhaps this is some of the most exciting time for semiconductor research, from a historical point of view. And for my own research at the University of Michigan, we have very talented colleagues working in materials, in device systems, circuits, and applications. So I'm very fortunate to be a faculty member at the University of Michigan. So specifically for my own research, I focus on the development of next generation wide bandgap semiconductors. And then semiconductors can potentially be used to help make more efficient electronic optoelectronic devices, and also have some implication to make future quantum technologies closer to our life.
Special thanks to ZD on Me. For the Discovery Files, I'm Nate Podker. Please subscribe wherever you get podcasts, and if you like our program, share with a friend and consider leaving a review. Discover how the U.S. National Science Foundation is advancing research at nsf.gov.